Okay, today we'll be going over Chapter 2 from Concepts of Biology. This chapter deals with chemistry of life. So here's an example of DNA molecule, illustration of DNA molecule. It's a double helix DNA molecule. It's called a double helix because there are two of them. Nucleic acids are the macromolecules made up of repeating units called nucleotides that direct cellular activities such as cell division and protein synthesis. Each nucleotide is made up of a pentose sugar, nitrogen space, and the phosphate group. There are two types of nucleic acids, DNA and RNA, and they're all made up of atoms. So what are atoms? The matter, which occupies space and has mass, are made up of elements. And the elements are that which cannot be broken down further. And the atom is one unit of that element. There are 118 known elements, and 92 occurs naturally, and fewer than 30 occur in living cells. Why do we take mineral supplements? Minerals are often elements in their ionic forms, ionic salts. And minerals are also often function as cofactors for the enzymes. So for instance, iron is a cofactor for hemoglobin. All atoms are made up of protons, neutrons, and electrons. Exception is the hydrogen, which only has one proton and one electron, and no neutron. Proton has a charge of plus one and mass of one. Electron has charge of negative one, but mass of about zero. It has a negligible mass. Neutron has no charge, which is why it's called neutron, but has a mass of one. And how do we describe an atom? You describe an atom's mass using the atomic mass unit, or AMU. This is also known as the mass number. Isotopes have same number of protons, but they have different number of neutrons. So carbon 12 contains 6 protons and 6 neutrons, ergo mass number of 12, and the atomic number of 6, which is the same as a proton. But isotope carbon 14 contains 6 protons with 8 neutrons. So what is its mass number? Protons plus neutron, 8 plus 6, or 14. That's where that name comes from. So here's the periodic table showing all known elements. Atomic number is shown on the left, on top. The symbol name is in the middle. Atomic mass is under the symbol. And the columns, like here, shows the number of electron on the outside of the atom. And its chemical reactions depend on that, on those electrons on the outside, or valence shell, we call it. And the carbon dating is made possible because C14 is continually made in the atmosphere at a constant rate. So how does carbon dating work? C12 turns into C14 by cosmic rays constantly. And it's constant because the amount of cosmic ray is constant. And the plants constantly fix these carbon isotopes into glucose and other carbohydrates. And obviously animals eat the plants. Other animals eat the lower animals. So the level of carbon-14 remains constant in a living organism. It's about as same as in the level same as the level in the atmosphere. But once organism die, it no longer ingests this carbon isotope, and carbon-14 decays to nitrogen-14 by beta decay. And it takes something like 5,730 years for about half of originally fixed carbon-14 to decay to nitrogen-14, meaning 5,730-year-old specimen has half the C14 to C12 ratio compared to the original sample. So we said valence shell electrons are important for chemical bonds. So what are these bonds? Well, first, how does carbon even get fixed by the plants? Carbon fixing requires forming bonds. And what are these bonds? There are three types of bonds: ionic bonds, covalent bonds, and hydrogen bonds. Ionic bonds involve charged interactions between different charges. Covalent bonds involve sharing electrons either in a polar or nonpolar bond. And hydrogen bonds are dipole interaction, and these are what we call polar covalent bonds. And there's also a van der Waals interaction, which is similar to hydrogen bond, but without the H, but due to charges. So here's a water molecule with polar covalent bond. Its polar covalent bond arises due to these partial charges on hydrogen and then on oxygen. Oxygen tend to hoard more of the negative charge, so oxygen becomes partially negative, and that makes proton or hydrogen partially positive. Here's an example of nonpolar covalent bond, methane shown here. Here's an oxygen gas, O2, with two bonds or double bonds between them. And here are the three water molecule displaying hydrogen bonding. These are the charge interactions between negatively charged oxygen and partially positively charged hydrogen. It just comes down to water. Water is essential for life on Earth. About 60 to 70% of human body is made up of water. And hydrogen and oxygen in water form the polar covalent bond, differences in charge distribution. And oxygen hoards more of the electrons. This results in a dipole moment. Net dipole moment is that way, towards the oxygen. And it's negative here, it's positive here. And this is what allows these hydrogen bonds to form. It's a charge-charge interaction. This results in polar molecule like sugar to dissolve in water, because polar molecules are hydrophilic, but nonpolar molecules like oil do not dissolve in water. They're hydrophobic. That's why they float on top of the water like this. And properties of water, one important property of water is that it stabilizes the surrounding temperature, or temperature in general. When you sweat, as your sweat dries, your body cools down. Why is that? Because you use energy to break the hydrogen bond in your sweat, in your water, or water in your sweat. That energy is your body's heat. That's why your body cools down as you sweat. And temperature is the measure of kinetic energy. So higher the motion, higher the temperature. And water being liquid forms hydrogen bonds rapidly, which means water can absorb heat and change temperature minimally. And this is what we call heat capacity. Water has high heat capacity. It can absorb a lot of heat without changing temperature. And why is San Jose so much cooler than Merced? Because San Jose is right next to the ocean. And the ocean water is absorbing all the solar radiation. Water can also form lattice-like structure shown here through the hydrogen bonding. And this is the reason why it floats in water, because the rigid lattice structure formed by hydrogen bonding, when it freezes, it occupies less space or it's less dense. So the water flows under the ice, and ice floats on top of the water. That's why ice floats to the top, ice. So then why don't fish freeze under a frozen lake? Because ice provides insulation. Ice froze from the water because of the air outside. So the water flowing under the ice is always below, always above the freezing temperature. If it was below, it would float to the top and become ice. How do the fish under the water and under in a frozen lake breathe? They can breathe because there is a limited amount of oxygen diffusion through the ice, but also water retains a lot of the oxygen that's already been dissolved, so that they last throughout the winter. Polar covalent bonds is what underlies water's ability to serve as a solvent. And table salt is sodium chloride. And table salt has an ionic bond between the sodium plus ion and chloride minus ion. And water has partially positive charge and partially negative charge. So it can form a sphere of hydration around both sodium and chloride using these partial charges. For chloride here, it uses the partially positive hydrogen to form the hydration. For a positively charged sodium, it uses negatively partially charged oxygen to form the hydration. How is that possible? Again, it goes back to dipoles, both slightly and negatively and positively charged. Some other properties of water. Cohesion allows water to move up from the roots to the leaves. That's stated simply, but cohesion, without cohesion, this cannot occur, then trees cannot survive. And what allows cohesion to occur? Well, cohesion results directly from hydrogen bonding in water. And water also allows us to dissolve CO2 in our blood. And having CO2 dissolved in our blood allows us to be buffered. It's a strange concept. But using the carbonic acid, H2CO3, and bicarbonate, HCO3 minus anion, using both of these things in our blood, we are buffered because if proton concentration increases or acidity increases, bicarbonates will combine with the proton to create a bicarbonic acid and limit the decreases in pH. If hydroxyl group concentration increases, carbonic acid will rapidly dissociate into bicarbonate and proton ions, and the proton ions will then combine with hydroxyl ions, limiting the increase in pH. Remember, increasing pH is more basic, decreases in pH is more acidic. So there are four main types of biological macromolecules. There are the carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. And they're all very important components of the cell and perform wide array of functions and make up the majority of cell's dry mass. And biological macromolecules are organic, meaning it has carbon backbone or carbon-based. But why carbon? Because carbon is the smallest element that can form four covalent bonds, as you can see in methane example here. One, two, three, and four. And this allows carbon to form a long chain molecule while being very stable. And obviously, for fatty acids, amino acids, glucose, things like this, this long chain is absolutely necessary. Here's an example of fatty acid. Here's a carboxylic acid group, and this long chain of carbons. And here's an example of amino acid. Stop! And here's an example of glucose molecule. So let's delve into a little more details on each of these molecules, macromolecules. Carbohydrates, obviously we know carbohydrates a lot. Low carb diets, we carb load before important competitions if you're an athlete. It's an essential part of our diet. Grains, fruits, vegetables are all natural sources of carbohydrates, and they provide energy to the body through glucose, which is a simple sugar. They also have other important functions, and they all have this formula in this ratio, 1:2:2:1. There's one carbon, two hydrogen, and one oxygen. And you can classify these carbohydrates into monosaccharides, disaccharides, or polysaccharides. So a monosaccharide, mono means one, saccharide means sweet, typically are 3 to 6 carbons, and they use the suffix -os. So trioses, pentoses, hexoses, they all are sugars. Triose is a sugar with three carbon, pentose is a sugar with five carbons, and so on. And they're typically found in a ring form, not a chain form like this over here, in a solution. And glucose, shown here, has the formula C6H12O6. Again, the ratio is 1:2:1. It's the source of cells' energy. Cellular respiration turns glucose into ATP. And it's the photosynthesis that turns CO2 into glucose. This is what carbon fixation is. And the excess glucose is stored as a starch in a plant, and that's what we eat. Galactose, which is part of a lactose, fructose, which is found in fruits, are some other common monosaccharides. They also have same formula as the glucose, C6H12O6, but they differ structurally and because of that, chemically. And these are called isomers. So only difference really here between glucose over here and galactose is the location of this hydroxyl group. And difference between glucose and fructose is presence of double bond here, double bond the carboxyl acid group. Whereas carboxyl group is over here on glucose. And when these two monosaccharides undergo dehydration reaction, that is removing OH and H from these molecules, then that is called a dehydration reaction because they together form a water molecule. So essentially, water is leaving these two molecules. And also, every single one of these OH molecules, OH, all these OHs, they can form a bond with any of the Hs. Any of these H's. So given a glucose that's going to dimerize with another molecule of glucose, for instance, given a single hydroxyl group, it has five other H's that it can combine with. And there are five hydroxyl groups on a single molecule. That means 5 times 5 or 25 possible bond combination just between combining two sugars. just creating that sugar dimer, there are 25 possible combinations. That's how incredible biopolymers are. So how many possible combinations are there given a three sugar molecule? Well, it's five times five times five. Six sugar molecule is five times five times five times five times five times six times. It's 5 raised to the power of 6. Polysaccharides are what forms from adding the polysaccharides are the ones, the molecules that form from adding many, many, many of those sugar monomers. The example of that is starch, glycogen, cellulose, and chitin. They're all made from sugars. They're all used by different things. Starch is found in plants as amylose or amylopectins. They're also polymers of glucose. They're stored in roots and seeds. Glycogen is a stored glucose polymer that's found in humans and animals. These gets broken down to release glucose. And cellulose are the natural biopolymers. These make up the cell wall of plants. Wood, paper, they're mostly cellulosic in nature. And there's this one other polysaccharide called the chitin that's mainly made from sugar molecules. Example of chitin is here. But they have this protein or amino acid residue attached to it. That is an alanine. It's a nitrogenous, and that's why we call that nitrogenous carbohydrate. Now moving on to another class of macromolecules, lipids.